Hey there, welcome to the show. This is the Magician and the Fool podcast, and we are on episode number 14. Today we have the pleasure of speaking with Mr. Marcus McCoy. Marcus is a magician, alchemist, blacksmith, perfumer, herbalist. Marcus holds a degree in transpersonal anthropology with a focus on the ethnobotany of magical plants. Marcus studied South American vegetalismo for many years, which is where he started his focus on perfumerismo. He is a professional perfumer and proprietor of House of Orpheus, and he's an alchemical practitioner studying with Robert Bartlett. Marcus is also a blacksmith with a special interest in focusing on the occult art of herbal quenches, working within the context of alchemical philosophy and folk magic. His smithy is called Troll Cunning Forge, and he produces custom-made occult ironwork for the occult community. You can find out about Troll Cunning Forge on Facebook and Instagram, House of Orpheus at houseoforpheus.com, and his Viridis Genii Symposium at viridisgenii.com, V-E-R-I-D-I-S-G-E-N-I-I.com. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later in the show. Just a reminder, we have a Patreon. You can find the Patreon at patreon.com, or you can find it through our website, themagicianandthefool.podbean.com. Please help us make the show self-sustainable. Thank you to those who have helped in that regard. It's greatly appreciated. And without any further delay, here is the interview with Marcus. Okay, we are here with the interview, and I'm here with my co-host Janice. As always, Janice, how are you?
I'm very well. Hello, everybody.
Hey, and we are here today to talk to the one and only Marcus McCoy about all sorts of topics. Marcus is a blacksmith, a herbalist, a perfumist, among other things, a jack of all trades. Marcus, welcome to the show. How are you?
I'm doing good.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks for coming on.
Yeah, for sure.
So we were talking a little bit before we started recording, and we decided maybe let's backtrack a little bit. So can you maybe tell the audience and us about a little bit about yourself and how you got into the whole esoteric scene?
I think my primary introduction to the esoteric scene was death. How old are you when you're in the fourth grade? 10, 12, something like that?
Yeah, nine, 10.
I watched my grandfather drown in his own bodily fluids for several hours. And it's kind of said that, you know, and also in some necromancy traditions, you know, you make a pact or give a part of your soul or personhood to the dead. And now there's a part of you in the realm of the dead and in the part of the living. And that way you're able to see the spirits and see the realm of the dead. And I think that, I know that that's what happened to me. But not intentionally. And so throughout my life, I was from that point on, I was totally interested in the paranormal, supernatural, anything that had to deal with life after death or the spirit world or anything like that. And so I just kept pursuing it. And around when I was in my late teens, I got really interested in indigenous people's use of plants, hallucinogenic plants or visionary plants would be a better term for them, for interacting with the spirit world. And so I started studying about them, studying ethnobotany, kind of grew up with back to the land hippie parents, back to the land Christian hippies. And, you know, Reagan came and they became less hippies and more conservative. But they were still, you know, they used to make their own yogurt and they were interested in herbs and alternative treatments. And we lived way out in the middle of nowhere in rural Oregon. And so didn't go to the doctor very often, just took care of yourself. So herbalism was just kind of, we didn't even call it herbalism. We were just, we're learning about different plants and different things that you could do to survive or treat yourself or a wound or whatever. And then when I was in college, that just became an interest in psychopharmacology and ethnobotany and anthropology and philosophy. And I continued to study all of that in college. I attended a Native American church meeting right before I left Oregon for Washington. That was really an amazing experience. I learned a lot from that, and then continued to pursue different things. I met a retired metaphysical teacher named Victor Rowe, and he was a very interesting character. He grew up in the Theosophic Society. He was in his 80s and had a blue triangle tattooed on his forehead, and he had made millions of but he had made millions of dollars teaching people metaphysics. And he taught me the way it's done, so to speak. Kind of took me under his wings at the end of his life. And he had a group that would infiltrate other groups and then rise to their highest levels of initiation or whatever, and then pretty much take whatever they learned and go back and teach it to their group. And at one point, this guy was he was the submarine captain for L. Ron Hubbard.
What?
Yeah, he'd been in all these different, like, I mean, the tattoos from like a Mithra initiation. I mean, he knew about like the Order of the Peacock Angel, like all these things that I was just like learning about. He knew very intimately, and he could just talk metaphysics like nuts and philosophy. And he taught me some basic principle practices of spiritism. And I took that and applied it to working with psychoactive plants and substances, and started interacting and working with spirits pretty early. I think I was like 21 when I started doing that. And I could just, you know, once you could see and interact with the spiritual world as it was, not just your projections, you know, things changed completely for me. And then after that, I started working with a shaman from South America named Miguel Kaplan, who became a little bit more of a rock star and started sleeping with a lot of his students and stuff. So after about 6 years of working with him, I said bye-bye and stopped working with him. And it just, you know, it goes to show you can be good at what you do, but not a good person. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what I learned.
Did you travel to South America?
I would have him come up here. I would host.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, so he lived down there and he would come up here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, and if, you know, he lived in Bolivia, so he was, the American dollar was worth a lot in Bolivia. So he was making a pretty good amount of money from working with Americans. And it kind of showed. Money is very corrupting, I think, too. So worked with him, saw a lot of great things. Started writing based off of some of my visions, doing long dance ceremony with him about what I later called bioregional animism. And I had a blog and an online community focused on that subject, which was a term I coined. Nowadays, it's kind of been hard to take credit for it because so many other people want to. but that was me. That was my idea, vision. And I started teaching it to other people and writing about it, blogging about it. I don't blog anymore because of it, because people just really like to info mine blogs and take information from blogs and then regurgitate them or reprint it as their own work, and kind of got tired of that. So I took my blog down on bioregional animism.
Can you define that bioregional animism?
Bioregional animism is not just a combination of bioregionalism and animism, but it's sort of the binding agent behind it is somewhat of a depth or eco-psychology viewpoint of being place and recognizing yourself as place. And so animism being a relational ontology, you're actually establishing relationships with your larger self and through, you know, which is the land. And there's this unity or oneness that comes from the way of relating to the land in that way that informs us and guides us and helps shape new relational dynamics, new practices, new traditions. It was never really meant to be considered like bioregional animism or called bioregional animism. That was just a rough name to get people started. But really, it was to just encourage people to start a relationship of communion with place, the genus loci, if you will, and to start relating to it as like their larger self. So that new animist traditions could come through that relationship and through that communion. But yeah, a lot of people got into it for a while, and now it's a pretty big subject that other people have tried to take on. Not very well, but other people have kind of taken my idea and ran with it. And so does that explain it?
Yeah, no, that was good.
Then after that... I worked on that work for a number of years and continued to practice, you know, the curanderismo practice that I had learned from South America. And then I met my partner, Katamara, and she was one of the founders of the Esoteric Book Conference. And so she introduced me to all of this Western occultism and witchcraft and things that I just became, I was familiar with always, but, and kind of grew up reading and researching and things, but my heart was really just within indigenous traditions. And then I started realizing that I could expand that interest into Western occultism to learn what the indigenous mind of Western Europe believed in and how they interacted with the world around them and how they approached witchcraft, and then how that also influenced South American traditions as well. And I learned a lot. I started getting really into folk magic and the study of cross-cultural. I mean, what I've always done is study, my degree's in transpersonal anthropology. And so I've always been focused on studying other cultures' religious beliefs or spiritual beliefs, or supernatural beliefs. And part of some of my classes where you have to go and like sit with someone from another culture and start interviewing them about their views of the supernatural, you know, for example. And I did lots of that work interviewing. And so I really approach a lot of these things still from that same viewpoint, just like cross-cultural analysis and really learning how all these different traditions throughout history approach some of the same subjects. And so I met Kat through distilling, and I invited her over to come and check out my distillation setup. I was working within the psych unit where I was a counselor, and then I had a side business that I was trying to start with my business partner at the time, and that was called Cascadia Terroir. And what we did was distill local plants for their essential oils and then sell the essential oils and various products and things like that at the farmer's market. So we had a large still, had a 55-gallon stainless steel still, and she came over and checked it out, and I fell in love with her. And like I said, we started, she introduced me more to alchemy, which I'd already been sort of interested in, and a lot of other work that I'd already started looking into. And it was just this wonderful natural transition for me to enter into Western occultism.
And I would say that, like, it probably really enriched your understanding of Western occultism coming from that background. I know it definitely did that for me, because Dominic can speak to you know, because we've known each other since we were in our young teens. I had a similar sort of trajectory of interest with strong, like, interest in indigenous traditions and indigenous cultures and the use of entheogens mm-hmm. in a sacred context and things like that. And I know from on my end, it definitely enriched and really provided a fertile ground for understanding then European indigenous traditions and how those developed into the magical sort of paradigms that became very kind of, you know, integral later.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, one other thing I have to mention before we move on is, like, one thing that's always clear about you is how much you love Kat. And I think it's really beautiful thing to see. Like, it's just so clear, like, that you love her so much. And it's just a really inspiring thing to see that.
Oh, that's good. That's great to hear. I didn't know it was so obvious.
Yeah, it's very obvious and super positive.
Well, she's awesome.
So did your spirit, did your practice of interacting with spirits, did you see or did you develop a sort of change in the kind of spirits that you ended up interacting with once you started working more within, you know, like European witchcraft and, you know, like folk magic and stuff?
No, it's really interesting how things work out, you know, like how life kind of, you know, guides you to where you need to be at that time, you know. Like, I mean, I worked with tutelary spirits of all manner. You know, some of the first tutelary spirits I asked for to work with when I was 22. I was like, okay, it's always been really easy for me to interact with and contact different spirits. And so I would, like, ask for, all right, what's the highest spirit that I have available to me to work with? To help guide me and teach me. And so these two spirits show up and and they tell me, they spell out their names. They literally spell out their names. And I'm like, man, this sounds, why do these sound familiar? They almost sound like Middle Eastern. And they're like, don't worry, we'll let you know. And you'll find our names in a book. And I was like, okay, all right, sure. And so I'm at this bookstore, and I'm, like, in the occult section, and they tap me on the shoulder, you know, you can feel them, their presence, you know, like, and I kind of let them in, and they're like, it's the last book on the third shelf. Just look through that book and you'll find our names. So I open up the book and I start flipping to the E section and I find their names. And the book was a dictionary of angels' names. And so I'm this dirty little heathen who had, like, pretty much renounced Christianity at this point as, like, doesn't even exist. No, none of that stuff is real. None of it, not one bit, you know, and you know, I'm seeing, like, Elohim as being one of them, which literally felt like a huge group of, like, cold male beings that were just not very, there was no heart there. It was very cold. I didn't really enjoy working with them. And then there's this other spirit named Eloah, which was also in the book. And also, this was weird because Peter Gray spoke about Eloah at the Left Hand Path Consortium that we both spoke at. And I couldn't believe it, because I hadn't heard anyone talk about Eloah for years. And I also didn't know that Eloah was actually an angel that was invented by a French poet who,
interesting,
in the story, who in the story fell in love with Lucifer, and Lucifer took down to hell, which was just really fascinating to discover that. But at the time, when I see these in the book, I had this complete like freak out, like, oh my God, maybe this stuff is real. The Western stuff is real. So at any rate, I had worked with a lot of different spirits. But as my practice moved on through working with a Bolivian fellow, I primarily started working with just plants and animals, but then other supernatural beings like would show up and start teaching you things, like La Sarina showed up in a ceremony once, and she became.
I was about to ask you about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she's kind of one of the ones that started getting me to like produce perfumes and to explore that. And I can really thank her. I'm looking at her candle right now. I can really thank her for creating that dynamic in my life and that interest. But yeah, the spirit just show up. You see this mermaid. And it's like, I'd like to work with you. And I'm like, that's great. I'd like to work with you too. And so then it was just a matter of establishing a relationship and communicating and getting to know that spirit and getting to know how to work with them. I've introduced La Sarina to a group of women who work with her. And my God, watching how they like are guided by her, it's mind-blowing. It's really incredible watching it. Over the years, what ended up happening, especially right the year before I met Katamara, the mother of wolves started coming to me in visions. And I was like, who are you? Mother of wolves, this is awesome. And then I started looking, researching her more. And it was Hecate. And I was like, all right. So I started like, I had no interest in paganism my entire life. I knew about it. I'd read about it, but I didn't have any interest in it. And I think there are people that approach Hecate from a neo-pagan standpoint, but that's not how I do things. I approach things from the South American, like angle. And that's very different. And so a lot of my work was taking different plant teachers and communicating with her. And she started teaching me about witchcraft, folk magic, European mysteries. And I didn't really know anything about this Greek goddess. I was completely disconnected from the neo-pagan and the Western occult scene at that point. And then I started just kind of like reading different things and looking things up. And then I meet Kat, who's got like Hecate tattooed on the back of her neck. And like, yeah, it was just kind of, all right. Kat's like, picture, and she's in one of the books, Her Sacred Fires and Things, and on Hecate. And it was just, yeah, it was kind of natural. So,
And just for listeners who might not be familiar with, like, when you're talking about, like, say, the South American spirit, that model, you're really talking about like entheogens and sacred context, shamanic techniques, and direct, like, pretty much direct face-to-face interactions with spirits in a visionary state of
direct, mind. Completely direct. I mean, like.
It's not some like wishful thinking, like let's get naked and dance around a circle and pretend we're invoking a deity and really interact with our.
No, yeah, none of that. No, I mean, it's direct. I mean, like if you're in, for example, like if you're going to work with like San Martin de Porres, right? Like let's say you're doing, you're running a ceremony, and this is like what I'm talking about here is not how it's portrayed now and how you, this is not, tourism killed this in Peru. And in South America, like you don't find this sort of thing much outside of like families, private family groups and communities. But you don't get to go and hang out with the real deal anymore down in South America. And I know those people, and it's not the same. And so when you're working, when you say you've got a group of people and you can tell that they need just a basic limpia, you know, like cleansing and just a simple one just to get things started, because they're really dense, you know, like they're heavy and weighted down. And so you call on San Martin de Porres, and he goes around and he starts, and you actually see him in the room. You call on him, and he shows up, and he's there. You're not just praying prayers and like just, you know, like, and then, you know, in the invisible realm of the spirits that you can't possibly interact with or whatever, the blessings come down from heaven and then you're alleviated, or some miraculous sort of like subtle change occurs. No, it's very literal. The spirit is in the fucking room, and it's a saint, and he's cleaning you up, and he's going from person to person. And when it's your turn, he comes to you, he starts using a broom to brush you off, and then he starts telling you, you know, like all the things that you're doing wrong that you should be doing right as a good Catholic boy. And then you have to tell him, sorry, I'm not Catholic. I think we have a different value system. So thank you for your advice, but no thanks. That literally happened to me. So, you know, it was the same thing when with working with any spirit. You figure out how to call them up, and then you interact with them. It's very direct. There are similarities in, you know, like creating space, calling, you know, like securing the corners, working with the four directions. There's a lot of parallels between witchcraft and modern witchcraft or traditional witchcraft traditions that have come. And their ritual practices that have evolved, a lot of commonalities between that and what indigenous people do.
So Marcus, how did you get interested in the perfuming, the perfumerismo?
Perfumerismo. Yeah. So,
was that your instructor from Bolivia as well? Did he?
Yeah, kind of, in a way, he really inspired me with that, just because, that's part of the tradition. You take a mouthful of Florida water and you spray it on people, right, to cleanse them, and you do that with other perfumes too. Perfumes are a huge part of San Pedro curanderismo. There are a lot of different perfumes that they would add, like even old ones like Taboo and stuff. But they would put a little bit of Taboo. And you'd raise your mesa, you know, or raise your ritual altar, your table, which is like a reflection of the universe. And it has all the different beings that you have relationships established with on. And you would raise it by taking a tea of tobacco and in a shell and adding a little bit of that Taboo perfume. And then you'd drink it through your nose. And you would raise the power of your mesa by doing that. And but the perfumes are worked with in all kinds of different ways. You'll see throughout Latin America that, you know, and in the ATRs, that perfumes are worked with in all kinds of different ways. But a lot of this, they've shared a lot of stuff back and forth between each other. And I'm actually curious as to whether or not the Congolese traditions spread that to South American indigenous people historically, because I don't believe, you know, of course South American indigenous people didn't have hard alcohol to begin with, or distilled alcohol. That was something that came later, but the act of blowing the perfume, blowing the alcohol on people, that practice I think may have come from Africa originally and just spread through the rubber trade, which is fascinating and terrible subject. But at any rate, he made perfumes, and every time he would blast you with perfumes in ceremony, you felt it, and it was mind-blowing. And when I really got into it and really wanted to learn how to do it, he had done a dieta while making a perfume in the Amazon with Amazonian flowers, just macerating flowers into this perfume or this alcohol. And doing different acaros over it and calling on those plant spirits to to rest and to sit and to empower that perfume. And he blew it on me. And like, I started purging out of my lungs and just like, oh my God, just, oh, you know, all this emotional stuff. And I knew I needed to go back for another round, to really get the lesson. And so it sprays me again and I breathe it in. I breathe the perfume in and you're bringing the soul, the volatiles are the soul in alchemy. And so you're bringing the soul of those plants into your body. And now they're in your lungs. And so then they started communicating to me and they started talking to me, and I could hear their voices, the voices of these Amazonian flowers. And it was a really healing experience, but it was also just heavy as far as like the responsibility we have ecologically and how we're poisoning ourselves and our planet. And that's really a sad thing. So with that lesson, you know, I got interested in making perfumes and distilling and, you know, all the different ways that perfumes are made and what they're used for and how they're worked with magically. And, you know, when you start paying attention, you see that it's kind of all over the place. Little bits, pieces here and there, but people don't pay attention to it that much. But the actual practice is kind of like, it's considered just like a sub practice or like a sub specialty, like someone that's really good at working with perfumes or making perfumes for magical purposes. You know, that's called parfumerism. So just started practicing that and letting the spirits guide the process and the plants.
So a lot of that was self-taught. Or trial and error?
Well, you're learning from the spirits. So yeah. Being self-taught would mean that there was no one else around to help guide me. And that wasn't necessarily true. The way things are done within that tradition too, is that it's like, you've got a teacher, but he's kind of hands off and he just like, he may share certain techniques or different things with you, but it's really the spirits that are guiding all that. And so basically you just learn from your teacher how to establish and maintain relationships with other tutelary spirits. And so that's how you learn. You learn directly from these other tutelary spirits or tutelary plants even. And so that's just how I've always approached things since. That's how I approached my work with Saint Cyprian. And pretty much everything I do is like that.
Cool. So who would you say, as far as local plant teachers, who are your most influential local plant teachers that you go to?
Well, it seems like every year another one volunteers. And I spend a lot of time getting to know a new plant every year. Right now, the relationship mystery that I'm learning currently is wild ginger that's re-immersed itself. I recently just found this huge patch, and I've always been just utterly fascinated by it because it's such a unique plant, and its smell is amazing. It's also one of its names is snake root, which is also very interesting. And its flowers are like this bizarre jester cap that never really poke up underneath of their leaves. They just kind of stay hidden until you dig through and find them. And their colors are purple and white, and it's just fascinating. And then their leaves are heart-shaped. And so from a, you know, doctrine of signature standpoint and from an animist standpoint, you know, getting to know this plant has been really interesting. It's been fascinating. But I haven't been able to find enough patches of it in the woods, in the wild and I've been looking for, you know, 13 years. And just now moving up here and going up into the mountains, I found this amazing patch where I found like more of it than I ever have in my entire life. So right [S2] Cool. [S1] Now it's like inviting me. It's like wanting to talk to me. It's like introducing itself. It volunteered, you know? I'm one of the powerful ones that a lot of people go to a lot around here, though I don't think they know what to do with it. or how to relate to it. It's probably Devil's Club. That's a huge one. But the local mushroom species are and many types of different mushrooms, medicinal mushrooms, are huge. We have a bunch of different Ganoderma varieties, which are the Lingxi polypore or the Reishi mushroom. And as I get older, especially, it becomes more of an important plant with autoimmune disorders, arthritis, things like that. But getting to know that mushroom and its spirit and all the many different forms of it, it's been really important for me up here. But there are a lot of different mushrooms. I used to work for Paul Stamets. I worked for him for about a year at Fungi Perfecti. And yeah, I had roommates that worked for him for years that I'm still good friends with, and I still know people that work there.
I order stuff from him.
Really good, yeah. Yeah, I'm really fascinated and really love mushrooms. I love going out and wildcrafting and just going out into the wilderness and harvesting anything is just one of my favorite things to do. Pastimes. And so anything that can get me out into the woods to harvest things and be out in the wild is just, I just love that. But the psychoactive mushrooms that are around here, especially psilocybe sinensin, that has been a great ally of mine for years and years. They always come to me in dreams and tell me, show me where they're growing. And then I go to the place that I saw in my dream the next day, and they'll be growing there. And that's how I've found patches of that for over 20 years.
That's awesome.
But yeah, people have a really weird relationship with mushrooms because they've been treated like a recreational substance and concerts and festivals and things like that for so long. People just don't know how to relate to them as being a sentient being that's wiser than you are. And they don't know how to engage in like different things like cleansing and then calling on different spirits and working with the spirit of the mushroom to do all that stuff and reverence. People don't know how to do that. So their experiences and what they project onto that experience are really piss poor.
They're shallow, superficial experience. Yeah. Because mushroom plants are people too, and spirits are people.
Yeah,
I totally agree with you. It's kind of like, look at tobacco in most indigenous traditions. You know, mm-hmm. It's a very sacred substance. Mm-hmm. It's used across the Americas, and yet it is a primary. It's basically turned into a zombie and used to enslave people mm-hmm. to parasitic corporations. Mm-hmm. And I find that to be really illustrative of what you're describing, because here we have a sacred being that's essentially giving its body to us,
yeah.
You know, and sharing itself with us to enrich our lives, and is treated with great reverence in a indigenous context, in a shamanic context.
Well, I mean, if people knew what you could do with tobacco, it'd blow their minds. You know, like, I mean, the number of like magical operations and different things that are done just with tobacco alone, like Western occultists have no concept of that. You know? Like they just don't get it. And which is funny, because if you look at like Northern European or Northern Peruvian San Pedro curanderos, they're incorporating all kinds of Western occultism stuff into their work. You know, whether it's Solomonic magic or whatever, they incorporate all kinds of things, and it's real, and they get results, and it's
Wasn't that how you came across Cyprian?
What's that?
Isn't that how you met Cyprian?
Well, that's how I first got introduced to Cyprian, and was through San Pedro Curanderismo. But the majority of the curanderos that I work with wouldn't touch him with a 10-foot pole.
Interesting.
Yeah, no, it's if you work with him, you're running this gray area. You're trying to be more of a sorcerer, which is they frown on that. They're, you know, it's like, that's like Brujeria. And like, you shouldn't, you know, shouldn't touch that. It's bad, you know, but there are certain like curanderos that do, and they are also like a little bit more interested in the occult or within, getting things done or things that would probably be judged poorly by their peers. We could also get them in trouble. I mean, like if you're convicted of being a sorcerer, it's because, you know, you're doing sorcery on people. And I'm sorry, but it's not like Instagram witchcraft. You're or Tumblr witchcraft. You're actually successfully killing people. That's real witchcraft. Is successfully killing another person with magic. Everywhere but the United States.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not a costume party.
Right. So you don't really want other people to know that you're doing that sort of thing. But he's really, you know, he was really good at removing evil spirits and witchcraft and spells. And so if he was worked with in that context, then that's acceptable. But it was believed by some of the people that I worked with, some of the maestros, that if you do that, then you're opening up like this temptation, like this, like the, you're creating this opening for evil and temptation to like come into your life, you know? And I was just always kind of like, you know, I think that's bullshit. And there's also in South America, there's this, you've got like three different categories of practitioner. You've got a curandero who would never do anything but treat people. You know, even the martial magic that they do is only for protection. That's it. Right? They would never harm, you know, anyone. And then you've got brujos, which are the witches who do malevolent, socially unsanctioned magic, or manipulative magic, which is also considered socially unsanctioned, love spells, things like that. And then you've got your people that are the shamans, which are kind of like they're considered outside of civilized society. They're a force of nature. So they don't, the moral duality of the curandero and the brujo don't really seem to apply to them. And that's interesting. So I always related to that. So working with Saint Cyprian to me was kind of a draw that came later. And he was more of I wanted to work with him as a tutelary spirit for accessing this sort of like bridge between the South American practices that I had studied and learned from and Western occultism, which influenced it as well. So
yeah, he seems like a perfect bridge.
He was a perfect bridge for that. And when he first came on, it came on really strong and it was really tremendously powerful work. But like with all the teachers that I work with, you know, you kind of graduate or become less reliant upon them and their guidance as you become more proficient in what they teach you. And so I'm not like it feels like everybody else has turned it into like a cult icon. And they're doing novenas all the time. They're doing this and that and trying to like, you know, maintain this reverent and worshipful relationship with them. I'm just kind of, it's just not, I don't know. It's not how I do things. So I don't work it that way. And I don't feel it's requested of me to do that either. So my work with him is kind of like simmered down a bit.
Well, it's funny because he's goes back to that spirits are people. Like, I wouldn't worship any teacher I had, no matter how amazing they were. I would show them respect.
It's folly.
Yeah. You make an idol out of that. Mm. And that's, you know, it's ultimately based in ego. I think that's kind of like sorceress in itself.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
In the negative connotation of the word.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And there's a lot of people teacher-wise that set themselves up in that position to be dependent upon them.
Yeah, and that's when I come out blasting with my gat.
Yeah. Yep, same. I'm a very critical person of that. And people in general, practitioners, practices, people that are in the public eye.
You see what happens. I mean, your instructor from Bolivia is a perfect example, and there's countless other examples of all these gurus who, you know, they get famous and it goes to their head, and you know.
Right. Well, and my old teacher, one of my first metaphysical teachers, Victor. I mean, he taught me how to use people. He's just basically, it's like you have your group that you work with, that you do the real work with, and then you have your dairy cattle that feed you.
Yeah.
And this is how Western metaphysical practice and occultism has gone for a long time. A lot of people follow this model, and a lot of people don't know that a lot of people and a lot of their teachers follow this model, and a lot of organizations follow that model. And, you know, you just come up with, you know, something that's believable enough that, or a lie that you believe even.
Yeah.
You know, that's the best kind. And, present that to people and create a cult following around yourself as a teacher or leader or what have you, and then you continue to milk people while you're doing your great work, you know. And I felt dirty learning that, and I refused to do it. So I'm very critical, and I know how that it's done, and I watch other people do these things. And now that we have the online community as strong as it is with this, you see it even more strongly. The cult of personalities are enormous out there.
There's a bunch of jokers.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, honestly. But one thing, because we could spend a whole show talking about that. But one thing I want to ask you, if this is your experience, it seems to me kind of like people in our lives, you know, like, when, you know, you have different friends that come through, you spend a lot of time with them, and then just the way life works, they move away or you drift apart, and then you have another friend that, you know, you develop a relationship with a friend or group of friends, but then you have those friends that are close with you your whole life. And I think it's like that with spirits too. It's like there's cyclical, and I wanted to ask you your opinion and insights on that idea.
Oh, I totally agree. I mean, yeah, I mean, it's very much like everything, if you look at everything as a teacher, right? If everything is teaching you, guiding you, helping you grow, also there's a big degree of protecting you, that goes along with being a teacher. And if you think of everything in your life as being a teacher, then yeah, your teachers are showing up constantly left and right and moving in and out. As you learn the lesson, you don't require their presence anymore, but they'll always be a part of you, you know?
Absolutely.
And I've had lots of teachers that were friends that this has happened with, and lots of spirits. Like, I would say that, I mean, one of the tutelary spirits that I worked with was from Central Asia, and he taught me how to throat sing and to utilize that in the work that I was doing. And
that's amazing.
And you know, I didn't have anyone teach me how to do it. The spirit from this old shaman from Central Asia taught me how to do it. And I learned a whole bunch from that spirit. And every once in a while, when I need something to, you know, when I need to do a particular type of work or something, he'll show up. But I'm not constantly sitting with that spirit or calling them. We just kind of have a relationship that's like an old friend, you know, like anytime I call, they show up and we'll get the work done, you know. Like, it's like your friend that has the truck.
Oh, yeah. I used to be that guy.
You're always going to be close friends. but I've established, you know, a lot of different relationships with lots of different animal spirits and different forces of nature and places and, you know, different beings all over the board. And I'm glad I have those relationships, but I'm not constantly like throwing a party for all of them, or I'm not constantly like sitting down and talking with that one particular one all the time. And yeah, the lessons come and go, you know? And so does some of those relationships. It's very much like what you said.
Look at what you were saying about La Serena. I mean, you clearly had a direct relationship with her for a while, and then she moved like through you. She moved into this whole group of women that she now works with.
Yeah. And well, and that was perfect, because it was for me, for her, the, what she did with me and what she helped me a lot was, helping heal different women's self-esteem issues.
Oh.
And it was like the, you know, she teaches love magic, but one of the most powerful ways of harnessing that is to teach someone the magic of loving yourself. And I, you know, like, I know that sounds really cheesy and kind of cliche, but it's really important. I think it's really important for women, because there's so much in our society and in the media and stuff that really take that self-love away from women and twist it and turn it into something really ugly even. And so working with that spirit to help women heal that and to find freedom within themselves and to learn how to drown sailors is a really good idea for a lot of women. And the women that I've introduced her to, you know, definitely agree. But do I work with her a lot all the time? No, I don't. But she's a friend. And when, you know, like when, and I acknowledged her, and when a woman comes to me in need of certain types of help, I will introduce her to my friend, and my friend will help her.
That's great.
Because we already have a relationship.
Switching gears a little bit. What's this botany of the dead thing that you were teaching? I came across that while I was kind of investigating a little bit about you, and that kind of piqued my interest. What is that all about?
I think the recording of that is still available on my House of Orpheus Etsy page, which I horribly neglect because I hate Etsy now. But I think it's still there. And if it's not, please let me know, and I'll just refresh that so that it's available again. But you could just, yeah, I think it's like $40 to get a recorded hour of the class. And it's basically, it's just like working, you know, all the different folklore and all the different plants that are worked with in regards to working with the dead, and all the different ways that the dead are worked with or gotten rid of or cleansed from your space or removed from a person, exercised from a person. I've been working with dead folk as mediumistically for like over 20 years. And so like noticing all the different plants and all their different relationships with and how they interact with the dead or how they affect the dead has been utterly fascinating. There's a guy, a book called Necromancy, Communication with the Dead, I believe, by Martin Coleman. And that book, I know the author. He's a elderly gentleman at this point and very, very knowledgeable, and also kind of a teacher to other people that I respect a lot. And he wrote, he had all kinds of great plants in there that I had never heard of. And I started researching and like figuring out, well, where does this come from? And there was this dogwood, using dogwood to neutralize or stupefy the spirits of the dead. I thought that was fascinating. So like when you're going into a house that has a spiritual infection, and there's all these, you know, dead folks causing problems in this home and on these people, you can spray dogwood water or a tea of dogwood everywhere, and it'll or even make a powder of the stuff, mix it with cascaria, which is eggshell powder, and then just blow that so that it's a cloud of it where the spirit would be in the home. And it just stupefies them. It just like renders their power like neutralized. They've got nothing. It's like it makes them drunk. And so I was fascinated by that. I was like, that's so useful. And where does this come from? And I realized that it was Jamaican dogwood specifically where this came from. And he probably learned that from someone in the islands somewhere, or like maybe it's got to be a practice done by one of the spiritism traditions or occult traditions within, you know, maybe possibly even, oh God, what's the Jamaican one?
Obia.
Yeah, Obia. Yeah. It may even have come from that. Seeing how it's Jamaican dogwood that was used, but it was the indigenous people shared this knowledge with the people there, and it was used as a fish poison.
Interesting.
So you take the bark or a tea or whatever or powder of the bark, and you throw it into the water, and the fish would get like drunk and passed out, and so they would float up to the top, and you could just grab the fish out of the water, but it wouldn't hurt you, it wouldn't poison you, right? And so they applied the same sort of sympathetic magical doctrine of signature sort of approach
to the spirit world,
the spirit world, and it worked.
That's cool.
So to me, that's fascinating as hell. And so there's all kinds of folklore like that when it in regards to working with the dead or commanding the dead or working with problematic dead or what have you. I mean, there are so many different plants for contacting the dead, for seeing and interacting with the dead. What's their folklore? What's their story? What's their usage? And so the botany of the dead was a class that I talked where I just focused on that.
Okay. And that that's fascinating. So we'll definitely link to that. We'll make sure that it's on Etsy first of all, and then link to it. Cause that sounds awesome.
It sounds fantastic.
Yeah, it was fun. It was fun. Yeah. At that time when I made that recording, I did not realize, I had not figured out yet that it was just specifically Jamaican dogwood that was used for that, or that had that effect as a fish poison. But what I was finding at the time was that dogwood had a rich, rich relationship with necromancy around the world. With warding off evil spirits in China, with the fruits and the flowers. The flowers form a white cross. So, you know, it was one of the many trees that was associated with the wood that was used to make the cross that they crucified Christ on. There's all kinds of folklore about it being used to combat evil spirits and things around the world. In China, they call them wolf eyes. They're said to terrify the evil spirits.
It's also,
but I didn't
exquisite tree. They're beautiful.
Oh yeah, no, they're one of my favorite flowering trees. They're just absolutely gorgeous. But yeah, at the time I hadn't pieced together the fish poison component yet. It took a couple years of researching that before I finally found that little piece of information. But I was intrigued as hell. I was like, where did that come from? And yerba mate was another one that he mentioned that got me really all riled up. I was like, this is fascinating. Yerba mate will also render a spirit powerless. And I find it fascinating because yerba mate is like super high in iron, super high. I mean, if you're flying with a head full of LSD, I challenge you to drink a bunch of yerba mate and see what happens. Like it will ground your ass like severely. That's another subject.
So when did you get when did you start your journey in alchemy? You've studied under Robert Bartlett. When did that start?
Bartlett, yeah. Well, that was the interesting, you know, when I started distilling, I started realizing that we were utilizing natural processes that were just imitating nature itself. And I was like, you know, alchemy is fascinating, but I didn't really, you know, I looked into like some of the local classes and teachers and things and found it fascinating, looked at some websites of different groups that teach and things, but I didn't really pursue it. I've always been pretty thrifty when it comes to wanting to take workshops or pay for knowledge. And so it wasn't until I met Kat, and she had taken classes with Robert. And then, of course, I meet Robert, became friends with Robert, and eventually, it wasn't until, I think, after our first Viridis Genii Symposium, Kat took some of the money from what we had earned for that and finally paid for me to go and take a prima with Robert. So, and this was long after we had met and hung out at the Alchemy conference that he put on, and where I got to meet a lot of local practitioners of alchemy, or not local, but in people from the United States at least. I studied with him and done some private projects together, which have been fun. And I've taken secunda from him, but I just haven't done tertia. So I'm still studying with Robert.
Cool.
And that's been a really amazing relationship. And I highly respect Robert as being one of the most incredible masters of alchemy, most knowledgeable of Egyptian history and magic as well, and its relationship with laboratory alchemy and philosophical alchemy. He's genius. That's all I'm going to say. I mean, he didn't write this as an article for event, British Genii Symposium. He spoke on it, so if you were there that year, you got to hear about it. But he hasn't written anything on this research yet. I mean, he's written tons, but nothing published yet. He discovered that you can distill the four humors out of anything.
Wow.
And you can actually see the four humors, and I've done it with him, and you can actually see the four humors. And then you can compare them to, because there's huge lists by all of the massive, like, alchemists and philosophers and medical practitioners at the time of what these different, what the different humors were of these different plants, and humoral medicine relied upon that. And so you can literally, it's real.
Wow.
The humors are real, and you can see them, and they match up to what these philosophers believe.
It's amazing.
It's incredible. It's mind blowing. My mind immediately went to like the astrological method of figuring out what your humor was, and are you phlegmatic, or are you what's your humor? And so there's an astrological method for doing that. I'd love to see whether or not it matches up, but I'd have to distill someone to do it, which I'm kind of excited to do. So if anyone wants to donate their body to alchemy, you know where to find me.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised if old alchemists back in the day might have used like fresh dead bodies for that or something. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah, I mean, there's tons of human mumia practice. You know, like, I mean, I know how to distill a human skull or a human brain or human blood.
Rad. Well, you know, now that you've said that, give it about a week. We're going to see on the internet somebody having a class on how to distill the four spiritual humors or magical humors, and it'll be all about the sorceress applications of it.
Sure, yeah. People info mining podcasts. Yeah.
For the latest workshop. So we touched on your perfumery, we've touched on the alchemical aspect. And to me, the blacksmithing is almost like kind of a component of all of that. And it's so interesting to me that you do that too, because we just did a show on Zosimus of Panopolis. And, you know, if you go back to the beginnings of alchemy, it was directly associated with metalsmithing. And here you are, you're kind of living that. And, I'm just interested in your thoughts on that.
Well, there's a lot of stuff. Well, alchemy is what brought me into metalwork and got me interested in it in the first place, because there was a reference. There's always been these references to different herbal quenches and these different methods in the grimoires, for example, of quenching something in a plant, an infusion of a plant or an animal. And I wanted to know, like, what is that about? And where, what's the alchemical theory and stuff about that? And because they had to be informed by alchemy when they were doing this. And it's interesting because I look at all of these grimoires that have come after, like the Key of Solomon and stuff, and all these people's works and bodies of work, and even to the point of, like, you know, like the stuff you'd find, you know, from you know, in neo-paganism on how to consecrate your athame, you know, like, it's all, you know, or even mastering witchcraft, you know, there's all of these things still, like, where you either visualize, you know, that you're heating the knife up and then putting it into this, like, this sanctified water or herbal water or whatever. There's all this stuff that imitates that the alchemist and the blacksmith of yore. And so I was really, you know, I love using the word yore whenever I can. but I wanted to know, like, I was really fascinated by that. And of course, all the different folklore revolving around blacksmithing. And so Kat, as a present, got me a class with Cody Dickerson, and he was teaching a nail making class. And so I went and I did that, and it just, like, I was hooked, and it was like I'd done it before. And all of a sudden, all these things started kind of like clicking, but I hadn't really put all everything together yet. And then I went and took Secunda with Robert Bartlett, and we're sitting in class with him, and he's just bombarding you with tremendous knowledge, like a geyser. And the wheels start clicking, and I start to get this idea, like, and I ask him, I was like, so, because to get more detailed, is that we were doing a practice of basically capturing astrological influences by in plant salts, by putting the salts into a solution and then crystallizing them by putting a seed salt in with them. At that very moment, it goes from a solution, which is mutable, right? So if something's mutable, it's influenceable, and you can imprint things in it, right? So at that point, when it crystallizes, that planetary or astrological election that was going on at that very moment, it becomes crystallized within the plant salt. And so I'm thinking about this, and I'm like, this is the secret. This is the key to the alchemical key, the sorcerer's key of making magical swords and knives throughout the ancient world. This is how it was done. And I later, and I asked Robert, I'm like, Robert, is this what's going on when we quench steel or iron, you know, iron, steel, like at a hot temperature, whatever it's quenched in, it's in a mutable receiving state when it's red hot.
Right.
But then when you cool it, you're basically quickly cooling it to the point where it's no longer in a semi-liquid state. It's in a crystallized state. So it was the same as with the plant salts, but it's with the mineral world. And he's like, yeah, that's exactly what you're doing. And I was like, so if I quench it in something, it's going to get those properties of what I quenched it in. And also, if I do it at a particular astrological time, then you're also getting that astrological hour, time, or election, and its influences locked within the blade or the metal that you're working with anyway. And nobody knows this. This is lost. I don't know anyone that understands the alchemical, the actual raw nitty gritty reasoning behind it. And I just recently, a friend of mine, he does a esoteric art publishing with like Three Hands Press and stuff. And Joseph, he just posted this beautiful picture of an alchemical term for swords and blades that were made in Jacina, I believe. I may be butchering the pronunciation, but it was a way of basically trapping a daemon of a particular astrological election within the sword or the knife. And this was the basis for how we approach all the grimoire blades now. And it was an alchemical method, and it was probably originated within the Middle East. I'm definitely within the Middle East. And I'm like, this is what Agrippa talks about. And I've actually done this practice several times in making talismanic perfumes and different talismans in general with my friend Eric Perdue. And so what you do is you find the astrological election that's going to be the best for either the malevolent or benevolent use of this particular talisman. And then you do it during that time, and you make it within that hour. And then you take from the election that you've cast for it, and you make a depending on what planetary chemia that you're going to work with, you make a sigil based off of that, and it will also give you the letters of the daemon's name, right? Both the malevolent and the benevolent names. So then you take that name and the sigil, and you would, or just the sigil, and you would engrave either the malevolent or benevolent name of the daemon onto the sword. And not only would the sword be quenched during that period of time, but it would also have the sigil to command that spirit.
That's fascinating, and it makes total sense. So if you were going to make like a talismanic knife to, say, Mars, you would find a plant that was sympathetic to Mars,
mm-hmm.
and you would quench with that?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. Or an animal or different things, you know, like, or it depends, like, do I want to command something with this knife? Like, what am I going to use this magical knife for? What's its magical purpose going to be? And then that's when you really start exploring, looking and going like, okay, all right, well, I want it for this purpose, or I want it for that, or, you know, for commanding spirits of the dead, or for exorcising spirits of the dead. I took barbed wire from a cemetery and turned it into a bracelet, and quenched it in a quench that was used for commanding the dead.
That's awesome.
Wow.
Yeah. And so, and you can do that within like the day and hour of Saturn, if you want, or the day and hour of Jupiter, or the day and hour of Mars. You wouldn't do it in the day and hour. Maybe, I mean, if you wanted to make something for communicating with the dead, you know, the day of Saturn and the hour of Mercury, you know, or you can get really specific and you can work with, you know, really intense planetary elections. I have not yet made it I know a lot of astrologers, really good astrologers, so I can always lean on them. But I haven't, I haven't made it a priority yet to increase my astrological knowledge. And if I did so, I would probably just go with Hellenic, medieval astrology. Because that's what the alchemists used. It's a complete system. It's part of, you know, the Hermetic sciences and arts. And why would I do anything other than that? I don't know.
And so how long have you been doing the blacksmithing?
It will be like 2 years come this spring. So
okay, cool.
It's still fairly new. I took two classes from Cody. One was making a nail, the other one was the making a little blade and to go and harvest a hazel staying, and we did I think it was a 3-day class doing that, and that was fun, and a group of people, and learned some, you know, basic, you know, knife making stuff with him doing that. And then I invited him over here to do, to host at my house and in my forge and a primitive knife making class. And, that was fun. And then I happened to meet, a new friend who was a Forged in Fire champion, Ethan Kemp. He's a good buddy of mine and he has Kemp Forge. And he just moved to the little town, little hamlet that we live in. And so he's got a big, you know, hydraulic press and all the belt grinders and things that we need to make real fancy stuff. So I go over there and we work on different projects together. And just working with other blacksmiths is just a blast. You learn so much. And I'm really good at a striker team, which is where you get multiple people hammering at the same time on the same thing, and it's just fun. So yeah, still learning lots. I think everybody.
So you said you had a setup at your place there.
Mm-hmm, yeah, I have a forge here, and it's slowly getting walled in, so it's kind of open to the weather. So I've kind of slowed down this winter a little bit, but I've got a trident that I'm finishing up here before next week is over. And then I've got a couple other projects that are in the work for people. People want some ceremonial knives and things made. So I'll be doing some of that coming up here. But right now, I've been doing a lot of lab work. And so a lot of my attention and time has been going into working in the lab. It's too cold sometimes to go out into the forge, even though it's hot, sweaty work. It's still like the front of you is hot and the back of you is cold.
So what's the story of this Swedish spirit that lives in your forge?
Oh yeah. So
what's that?
So when I first moved here, I was like so excited about having this space, this over constructed like woodshed that we've got. And it just looked like it would be the perfect forge, and I just visualized it and I just so excited to have it. And so then I started building my forge and getting, you know, anvils and different hammers and all the things that I needed for it. And I got my propane forge from Lithuania, a company called Devil's Forge, and I was just so excited to start. And I was exploring the town because we just moved to this town too. I haven't lived here long. And I went to the graveyard, and at the crossroads of this graveyard is a memorial to blacksmiths. And it's a anvil that's been enameled over with black enamel, and it has a blacksmithing hammer welded to the top of it. And I was like, this is freaking ridiculous. What were the odds that there's a blacksmith memorial at a crossroads in a fucking graveyard?
So cool.
This is just insane. So it's so rad. And so I gave it a dime, and, you know, I paid for the dirt, and I took dirt from underneath of that, or at the base of that at the crossroad. And, I took it home and I put it underneath of my anvil, and I immediately felt from that point on that someone was standing behind me every time. And with a propane forge, it's loud. You can't hear. It's very, you know, it's like this roaring sound, and you're kind of cut off from your sense of hearing. So I never know if someone's coming up behind me. And so I'm very sensitive and aware of what's going on behind me when I'm in the forge. And from that point on, I always felt that that was, you know, that it was there. And then I would go to that location occasionally and pay for more dirt and bring it back and feed the forge or put some underneath the anvil. And the intensity of that feeling would increase. And I would just feel really intensely that there was someone standing behind me. And I was thinking, I was like, you know, it would be so cool to have a tomty or a tante, a niece, that helped me in my forge, you know, that protected my forge. That would be great. Because I'd met tomps in the past up in Seattle in the Norwegian district, actually. I met one in a home, and they're powerful beings. I mean, like, they will protect your home from very powerful malevolent beings, like very powerful. They can kick ass. And, you know, they may, you may think that they're like little David the gnomes, but they're not. And so, I was like just passively thinking, oh, that would be, that'd be really cool. And then it just never really occurred to me what this feeling of someone standing behind me really meant and what was going on there. Until I brought Johannes Garsbeck to dinner. He was staying with one of his students and teaching in the United States for the first time, and that just happened to be in my town. And we had been friends online for, I don't know, quite a few years, and it was really exciting to have him in the United States, and I'd learned a lot from being a part of his trolldom group, which he had deleted a couple years ago. And I mean, the guy's a brilliant practitioner and a brilliant folklorist and student of magic, folk magic. And he came over and we're drinking mead that I'd brewed with Kat, and we're having a nice time chatting. And I was like, hey, do you want to go see the forge? And he's like, oh yeah. He got all excited and he went out and he announced himself, knocked on the forge, which is the tradition, because if there is a tomt there, you need to alert your, announce yourself to the spirit, and so that it doesn't become startled or offended that you didn't. And so that's a common Scandinavian practice culturally, is you knock and announce yourself to the tomt, not the people that live there. Even if it's your own home, you do that. And so from what I've learned from Johannes. And so he does that and he walks in and he's like, there's a traditional trolldom blessing of the forge. I'm trying to remember what it is. Would you like me to do that? And I was like, hell yeah. And he's trying to remember and he's like thinking and he's touching the anvil. He's like, you've already got a tomt here. And I'm like, I do. And he's like, yeah.
What?
And now it all occurred to me. It just all made sense. There's a traditional trolldom Scandinavian practice to get a tomty or like a house spirit if you don't have one, or the one that you hadn't has left the house, or if it's a brand new house or and you need one. And so that practice, what you do is you go to a crossroad on a specific day once a week for 3 weeks, and you leave a dime or an offering for the spirit, and and all the time you're asking for spirit to come back with you to be your house guardian spirit. And when I went to the graveyard, to that particular, you know, memorial for blacksmiths, and I brought the dirt back, that's exactly what happens. You go back and you find something to bring back from that crossroad, whether it's a pebble or dirt or whatever, and you bring it home with you, and then that's where the spirit, you know, comes and it follows you. And I had done that without realizing.
What a crazy coincidence. It just so happens to also have been a tombstone set up, like with an anvil and a tombstone?
It's not a tombstone.
Oh,
it's
just a memorial.
But it was a memorial that was given by someone who had died, and there, you know, there was an old blacksmith that was in town.
How crazy.
Yeah, but it wasn't his grave, no. But it was a memorial to blacksmiths. And okay. Yeah, I just thought that was extraordinarily powerful and amazing and affirming and mysterious and just fascinating. I knock and leave him, you know, once a year at Christmas time or Yule, I leave a beer for him. And
Awesome.
Yeah.
So let's talk about Viridis Genii, because I want to make sure we touch on that, before the interview is up. And so could you tell us a little bit about that and when it started and, you know, what you guys are trying to accomplish with it?
Yeah. So Katamara and I, when we first got together, she was homesteading this piece of property in rural Washington. And we were talking about some of her frustrations and some of my frustrations, where it seemed just like the herbal community, the herbalism community, was just super new age focused. And like that's what they taught. Like all the people that taught about herbalism, you know, that had any spiritual background, was all coming from a new age point of view. And then you have the Western occult community, and you know, she, with her influence with the and interactions with so many different currents, so many different occultists through the esoteric book conference, you know, there's no one was really emphasizing stuff on plants, with the exception of Daniel Schulke and like the several of his books, but for the most part, there just wasn't anyone teaching about the esoteric herbalism. And yet at the same time, there were so many people that had interests in it that we knew, and good teachers that needed a place to talk about it. And so we came up with this conference, and we came up with the book that we did through working with Dr. Jennifer Zart. And it just was born. The hardest thing was to find a location for it. We knew we had plenty of people that we could come get to speak our first year, but it was finding a place to house a bunch of rowdy occultists that are interested in herbalism and occult herbalism. That was the hard part. So we eventually found this place that was a retreat center in Damascus, Oregon. And we held it there for a couple of years. The woman that was running the place was kind of like a hand-wringing teetotaler. And so,
perfect.
It didn't really work out for us. So we had to find another location. And we found this beautiful old school for sustainable forestry that's run by the University of Washington up in, it's the Pack National Forest, which is by Eatonville. It's like minutes from Eatonville, Washington. And that's right at the base of Mount Rainier. And it's a beautiful location with it, surrounded by a beautiful forest. And it had like all of these dorm like camps, because it's still a school, for college students. And so, and there's like main lodge and a big speaking hall, and it was just perfect. So now it has this kind of summer camp for occultists feel to it, which I kind of love. we've choreographed a lot of the stuff intentionally, because we wanted to change, to create changes in our community. I'm not going to say that I didn't, you know, Kat and I don't necessarily have agendas in the way that we choreograph the event and who speaks at it, but we do. We're highly focused on clarity and history, people knowing like where things come from, and just I really want to erode the current dependency on New Thought and the New Age in herbal practices and in occultism in general. And so we very carefully try to weed out any of that in the event, focusing instead upon historical practices, of alchemy, Western, Eastern. We had occultism. We had a wonderful Chinese medical practitioner speak at this last year's event on Gu, which is like these ghosts that possess you, and the different herbal treatments that are used to remove these spirits that cause health problems. That was fascinating. John Anderson did that, which was just an fascinating subject from the point of view of Eastern occultism, Chinese occultism. And then Jesse Hathaway has spoken multiple times on many different subjects, and we always love it when he comes and talks about Lakumi and the different herbs that are worked within Santeria. That's absolutely fascinating subject to me. And yeah, Robert Bartlett, with his, when he revealed that humoral distillation and the philosophy behind the humors, it was so valuable. But what's interesting and what's wonderful is that we're giving a place to help transform, to give a voice to different teachers that are passionate about esoteric herbalism, a voice to help transform the herbal community and as well as the occult community. You know, you get occultists that have never thought about herbalism but utilize herbs and their stuff. They've come thinking that they were just going to be around a bunch of hippies that were singing Kumbaya and talking about plants, and realized that it was a really hardcore occult conference that was focused on plants. And so that kind of blew their minds. I remember Austin Kopic, particularly when he came, he told us that that's what he was expecting and that he was very surprised and happy that it wasn't that way and that it was a very serious occult conference. So, you know, plants are kind of like herbs are like the nose in the center of someone's face. They shape someone's face. So people a lot of times don't realize just how important they are to the occult practices, all of the many that there are. And so people don't pay attention to them. They just use them like a tool or whatever, and they don't understand why they're doing what they're doing. It's just, you're supposed to use this plant. Okay. So we're trying to inform occultists, but we're also trying to, like I said, just kind of kick the new age out of it and give people something, some solid foundations and knowledge and some clarity on these subjects that aren't just piecemeal together haphazardly and brought together with new thought ideas or just energy, vibration, and frequency crap.
Well, that's an admirable aspiration, and we definitely support you 100% in that. How can people, when's the next one you guys are having? How can people learn about it? And how can people learn about, where can people find you and also find the amazing sense you guys make at House of Orpheus and just everything you do? Give us some info.
Sure. So, let's see. It's either July or... Yes, I believe it's July. I think it's going to be after this year. It's going to be after the 4th of July weekend, which, I'm sorry, let me ask my lovely partner. What is that? July 18th. She's the mistress of scheduling. What's that? July 19th through the 22nd. Okay. Katamara knows all. So we'll be having it then over that weekend, and it will be, like I said, in rural Washington, outside of Eatonville. And let's see,
how far is that from Seattle?
I think it's like an hour and a half, hour and 45 minutes. It's really not that far though from SeaTac, and so. What we've done in the past is that we've had a shuttle available for some people. Other people have rented cars and things like that. But yeah, you're not going to take the subway to it or the bus. So got to get a little creative in how you get there if you're not driving. So, and right now tickets are available at www.viridisgenii.com. And we have a payment plan that's available for people. And we've had donations given by different members so that we have a little scholarship. So different people that believe in it have created scholarships so that people that can't afford can apply. And so we have a little scholarship section on the website. But I think we only have enough for one scholarship and I think maybe half of a ticket available at this point. That may change, but right now that's what we have available. We really wanted to make sure that people that are disadvantaged somehow or, you know, having massive challenges in their life in some way, shape, or form have an ability to get there. And so it's really beautiful that people have donated money to make that happen for people. So that's really great. And there's also, I want to plug that there's a book that comes out every year based upon the writings of the people that presented at the event. And most of the time, the writing is on the subject that they presented on, and sometimes it's not. So we still want to motivate you to come to the event because we don't record it. We don't do things like that. What happens there is magical and you don't want to miss it. But the book is available through Revelore Publishing, and the name of it is Verdant Gnosis. And we're actually right now in the middle of editing and reviewing the articles that have been submitted for it right now, and we're really excited about what we're reading. It's going to be another really incredible year with some amazing presenters, teachers. Daniel Schulke is going to be there presenting this year, Corinne Boyer, a lot of really great people, just to name a few. And then if you'd like to find my perfumes are available at www.houseoforpheus.com. And then we do have some stuff available on Etsy, but I don't keep up with it. And if you really want the money to go directly to the artist, support their own website and don't shop on Etsy. If they have that as an option, support them directly. And then Troll Cunning Forge, I'm on Etsy, but I don't post much of my work on there. I have a few things that I have available, like if you want different horseshoe nails quenched in different poisons or magical plants, I have a few available that I just make available and that I have constantly on Etsy. And then Anvil Dust, because there isn't really a supplier of Anvil Dust anywhere, and there are several folk magic spells that require Anvil Dust, so I make sure that people have the ability to get some of my Anvil Dust. And then, let's see, pretty much if you want to find the things that I make, or if you'd like to request a piece made or something particularly made, I post everything that I'm doing and sell directly off of Instagram. So Troll Cunning Forge is my Instagram account, and you can find me there and just follow the hashtag Troll Cunning Forge. And yeah, I sell things just directly and kind of immediately. Anytime I make something new, post it, and it's usually gone within a day.
So. Nice. Well, Marcus, this has been awesome. We love talking to individuals that not only practice, but like live the lifestyle. So you are just living the life.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's funny, all your interests are so interrelated, the alchemy, the blacksmithing, the herbalism, and they really complement each other so nicely. So it's interesting.
what you've done.
Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah, we're honored, we're humbled, and we're grateful for you and for your work and for your conversation. We really loved having you on, and I feel like we were just hanging out together, just talking, and that's sometimes the best, you know.
Yeah, agreed. I love doing interviews. I'm a talker. You can ask me, she'll tell you. I love to talk and I love to teach, and I was a good counselor too, and so I enjoy talking about whatever, because I'm just enthusiastic and interested in the world, you know.
Yeah.
And I think I've learned that I have the ability to share that enthusiasm. You know, it's like getting possessed by spirits, you know, or possessed by the gods. You know, that's what enthusiasm.
Enthusiasmos, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And so I have the ability to share that, and I like to share that, like feeling that.
One thing I want to get out before I forget, before we end this interview or take a break from it until next time, is, mm-hmm. you know, one thing that came to mind when you were talking about Robert Bartlett and he was talking about the Egyptian stuff, it occurred to me that, you know, it's really interesting because the god in Memphis, the god Ta, well, really the Memphite triad of Ta, Sekhmet, and Nefertem dealt with exactly the things you do. The blacksmithing, perfumery, alchemy, you know, these are all things you do. And it just like clicked for me, and I wanted to get that out before I forgot about it.
Yeah. Yeah, they're all related. I mean, you look up like a, you know, Ogun, yep. you know, sent in Lukumi, and he's the god of blacksmithing and distilling spirits.
So interesting.
You know, I mean, it's like I can't, and it's all around the mastery of fire too. And I have to say, you know, like my name literally means full name is Marcus Riley McCoy. And that translates to the etymological origins of these words. What they mean is mighty warrior, valiant son of fire. And in Egypt, the alchemists were called the sons of fire. And they were the metal workers and the distillers and they did the blacksmithing and all the metalwork and the alchemical sciences and distillations and all that stuff. And I just find that utterly fascinating that sometimes your name can define like your life.
Amazing. Oh man. Well, thank you so much. This was fantastic. And we look forward to doing it again.
Yeah. Thank you, Marcus.
Yeah. I'd love to talk with you guys again. It's been a blast. So.
Cool, man. Thank you.
Have a good night. Time.
Well, thank you again to Marcus. That was an awesome interview. And Janice and I were just kind of talking about it. And it really does seem like Marcus is following his daimon. His daimon is guiding him to do exactly what he's doing. And he seems to be fulfilling exactly what he was born to do, which is awesome.
Well, at the same time, you know, he's navigating his destiny. He's holding the rudder of his ship, you know, and it's interesting because there is that synthesis between fate and free will when you're in harmony with your daimon. And that said, guys, you are listening. This is how magic really works. Listen, you know, the things that he was talking about, the way he was led from one thing to another, had different doors open, you know, you heard a real magician today. And that's something you need to think about, because if you notice, Marcus had courage to find his own way and to pursue his heart. And, you know, he's remained independent. And those are characteristics that are essential to a true magician, that independence, that listening to your heart, and those strong relationships, whether it's with people, whether it's with spirits, whether it's with plants, you know, or whatever else it may be, with the dead, with elementals like the Tomti. I mean, it's all about relationships. And I think Marcus really exemplifies that.
Yeah, he's got the right outlook, the intuition, and I really like what he was saying about taking plants to the next level in magic. Like it is true that a lot of magicians just use plants as tools. Like, oh, you need a little mugwort here, let's throw that in. But you could really take things to a much deeper level if you're looking at the spirits of those plants and communicating with those spirits rather than just using them as objects for a spell.
Exactly. And it kind of takes you out of the materialistic reductionism of the Western mindset, and it takes you back into the timeless and archaic spirit psychology of most indigenous peoples, which is really, I think, very, very good for the soul, because once you start realizing that plants are people, spirits are people, and respecting them as such, it just opens your awareness up to how much more broad an idea that consciousness is, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. So very cool. Janice, how can people find us and, you know, all that stuff that we say at the end of the shows?
Got a Facebook. We have a Patreon. We are on iTunes. We're on
YouTube, Stitcher, you know, everywhere you find all the other podcasts, you can find us there.
And if you're worth it enough, you could. I mean, if you want to try and contact us telepathically or through dreams, you know, go ahead, as long as it's respectful.
Yep, you can contact Janice through his dreams. Go for it. I'm cool, though. Don't. I'm good.
Just do it anyway, though. Just go to... I prefer you go to Dominic first. So try him. If he doesn't pick up, you know, give me a call.
All right, we will see you next time. Thank you for listening.
Signing off. Good night.